Hey y'all, it's Steffi and welcome back to my channel. So today we are going to be talking about a highly requested topic, which is the different jobs you can get in the accounting industry. So I'm just going to jump right into it. This may be a little bit long, so be sure to grab yourself a snack or a drink and let's go ahead and get started. So in case you are newer to my channel, hi, I'm Steffi. I am a CPA. I used to work in public accounting and now I work in industry, also known as private accounting, and I am an internal audit manager. So I've compiled a list of general job functions that you can do with an accounting degree. I did want to give a few high-level notes and disclaimers. First of all, of course, as an auditor, there's always disclaimers, right? Please keep in mind that what I am about to tell you is more of a general view. Everything is going to be different depending on the company that you work for. So first, I want to talk about jobs that are in industry, or also known as private accounting. The first type of job that you can get in accounting is what we call general ledger accounting. This is the day-to-day recording of business transactions within the accounting system. And I've done kind of like a very high-level basic video about what accounting is and what auditing is. So if you haven't seen that, I'm going to go ahead and link that in the cards. You are doing reconciliations. Here's this amount that's in my general ledger. Is that amount correct? Is it accurate? Do I have enough evidence or documentation to support that amount on my financial statements? Those are some of the more general duties. The busy time for someone in general ledger accounting is typically after month end. Usually there's about a 5 to 10 business day deadline, depending on the company. It's basically where you take all the transactions that occurred in the prior month and you just make sure all the numbers are correct. There's always a deadline every single month. Once that deadline's over, there may be some daily transactions that they have to do, or maybe there's some stuff they need to clean up that they weren't able to complete during month end, but it wasn't significant to the financial statement, so then they just take the rest of the month to clean it out. Generally, I see people in general ledger accounting working 40-hour work weeks throughout the month, maybe towards month end. While people are closing the books, you may end up working a bit more. It just depends on the company. But generally it's a 40-hour work week, a bit more busy towards month end and during your busy time. Part of general ledger accounting, they may ask you to help out with like certain analysis. Typically you're working at your company's office. Depending on the company, you may have some work from home options, some working remotely options. It's really going to depend on the company. For the most part, there's not a lot of travel involved unless you are doing the accounting for, you know, a location that's not where you're at currently. So it's really gonna depend, but generally there's not a lot of travel involved with general ledger accounting. Career progression, you will typically start as a staff accountant. Unlike public accounting, there's not a specific, you do this for 2 years, you do another thing for 2 years, and you're moving up a certain route. Private accounting and industry is a lot different because it really depends on business need. Do they need another senior accountant? Do they need another manager? Even if you may deserve it based on your merit, based on your contributions, if there's not a business need for it, you may not get a promotion until there's a vacancy, someone leaves the company, someone retires. I find more so moving up to senior is usually very normal in industry. I think that it gets more like to the manager and above level is really a lot more dependent on, is there a business need for that? As an entry-level person, you're the one who's preparing things. As you move up, the more responsibility you have. So when you move up to a senior position, in public accounting at least, you have people that you supervise. In industry, you may not actually supervise anyone. It may just be more of a distinction of your technical expertise and your experiences when you move up to a senior. And typically, whenever you're past staff to senior positions, you are not really preparing things as much. You may every now and then for more complex things, but you're not usually the one who's doing the work. You're more so reviewing things and you're more doing analysis, like more high level, like looking at the financial statements versus looking at the specific details, like looking into inventory balances. I will say though, as you move up and your salary moves up, your title moves up, the higher and higher of an expectation there is of you as a professional to deliver output, to deliver results. And that may mean you working more. Maybe that means you have more on your plate than you did when you were a staff or a senior, putting in more time, and not because someone's telling you, but because you as a professional know, I have these things to do, I can't get them all done in 40 hours. Maybe I have to work another hour or two a day. Not all the time. When you think about wanting to progress in your career, also think about what that comes with, the more you need to deliver results. So there's always a give and take, and it just depends on what you want in your life, in your career. We all want more money, but not everyone wants the added stress or the added time away from your family. So it really just depends. So the career progression there is staff accountant, senior accountant, manager, sometimes a senior manager, also called an assistant controller. Then you can move up to controller, and then eventually maybe you move up to like a chief accounting officer, and then maybe a chief financial officer in the future. In terms of education requirements, you definitely need to have a bachelor's degree at minimum to even just as an entry-level position. I'll talk about a caveat here in just a second. Based on what I've seen when I was looking for a job, moving up past a senior, I would typically see a requirement for a CPA, and sometimes they would say master's degree, which is why I am such a supporter of y'all going for your CPA and why I think it's really important. It's because of moving up in your career. It's very important, but of course, if you're happy being a staff or a senior, then you know that's totally fine too. Not everyone has to or wants to move up in the hierarchy, and that's totally fine too. The caveat to this, for certain positions in accounting, such as accounts payable, where that's paying money to vendors for services or products, and then accounts receivable, which is your company receiving money from your customers, those two departments which fall under accounting do not really require a whole lot of accounting knowledge. I've seen people who work in those roles who either have an associate's degree or even don't even have a accounting degree of any kind. That, however, is a stable position. If you don't have a college degree, unfortunately, that does factor into your salary potential when you're talking about general corporate environments. To each their own, and just depends on what you want in life. SEC or financial reporting, those terms are kind of used interchangeably. Usually for a public company that's traded on the stock market, once your month end is complete, they'll take that and put it into the financial statement template. So they create the balance sheet, the income statement, cash flows. Along with the financial statements, there will be footnotes, sections that explain a bit more of what's happening in the financial statement. So it could be talking about cash movements or debt or something like that. It just gives more of a picture about what's happening at a specific company. So this department really owns that process. Deadline would be quarter end, and then your year end. They would be at the office. Every now and then they'd work from home, but of course that depends on the company. Didn't really work a whole lot outside of like 40 hour work weeks outside of quarter end. Quarter end they would work a lot more. And a lot of my public clients, they would be there kind of later, like midnight, sometimes 2 o'clock or whatever. It just depends on the company. To compensate for that, I find that SEC or financial reporting positions pay a bit higher than general ledger accounting. You have to be in the know and stay up to date with changes in the accounting standards. So you're constantly having to learn new things on how to report on certain transactions. Also have to do that in general ledger accounting, but especially in SEC reporting. I do find that SEC reporting also can take on a technical accounting aspect, which I'm not gonna really get into a lot of detail about that. Technical accounting is just having a lot of more specialized knowledge about accounting transactions, usually more complex. And I find that when you go into public accounting, you get a lot more of that technical accounting knowledge, which is great for your career. There is no travel when it comes to SEC or financial reporting positions, other than maybe CPE, like training events and that type of stuff. But in terms of your actual work requirements, there's usually no travel. Career progression is similar to that of general ledger accounting. Education requirement, you definitely have to have your bachelor's degree in accounting at minimum, because it's dealing with more technical and complex accounting issues. They usually look for people with either a CPA or a master's, or who is CPA eligible. I know you're probably gonna get annoyed of me saying that, but I'm here to give you truth, okay? The third job function you can get in industry is more related to tax. So there is usually a tax department in every company. They'll calculate state income tax and file those returns, you know, during the specific deadlines. I'm sorry, I don't really know all that much about tax. They're preparing the tax provisions, amount of taxes that they think that the company is going to owe at the end of the year to the IRS. That calculation is usually given to the general ledger accounting group on a quarterly basis, and all that other jazz that goes on with tax. A department that does it for the company on its own. Minimal travel as well, although it just really depends on the company. For example, my company is an international company, goes and travels internationally to consult on specific things, tax-related type things. However, I see that more at like the management and above level versus as a senior staff. Career progression is also very similar to what I've already described. I've seen more that in tax-related positions, they ask more for a bachelor's degree and then also a master's degree. So I really think that if you go the tax route, it would be beneficial to do a master's in taxation. Food for thought there if you end up wanting to do tax. And I know I didn't talk about that one as much because I don't know as much about tax as I do about the other one. Fourth and the best kind, my most favorite kind, and I'm obviously biased because I work in it, it is the internal audit department or internal controls. I'm going to link a video I did, which is up here, where I kind of talk about what are internal controls. I talk about the Sarbanes-Oxley Act, just to give you more information about what that all means. Every company will typically have policies and procedures about this is how you're supposed to do something. What we focus on is stuff that would affect the financial statements. This is the way that you're supposed to do reconciliations. This is the way you're supposed to do journal entries. This is how you're supposed to process vendor payments. Internal audit go in and test that these policies and controls are in place. And controls are just checks and balances. So like I was saying earlier, as a staff accountant, you're preparing things. No person is perfect. To have a good internal controls environment, someone who is qualified, has sufficient knowledge, education, would review what another person has done. Reduces errors, it reduces potentials for fraud. So as internal audit, we go in, we learn about the processes, learn about the policies. Sometimes we help create those things if they are missing, and then we test to check if controls are working appropriately. At the end of the year, when your external auditor comes in, not only checking the numbers are correct, but also checking that the controls worked as they should have. It's the job of internal audit to testing those things. Is it working throughout the year? If not, then we help and provide improvement recommendations. We identify those weaknesses, those deficiencies, and we work with the process and control owners to fix those things. When you're an internal audit, you know, you're still an independent person outside of accounting. I want to find the issues first before our external auditors do. In a way, it feels like you're kind of more owning what's happening with your company versus being an external auditor where, you know, you really have no skin in the game other than them being your clients. That's what I like about internal audit. I really enjoy learning about the processes, seeing a revenue amount in your actual general ledger or financial statement. And it's another thing to really understand, like, how did it get in there? How do they even begin from cradle to grave? So that's what internal audit does. Internal audit is the place to go if you want to actually travel. If you want to travel internationally, you need to work for an international company. If you are new to the Subby fam, then I'll fill you in. I have been in the past year to Zurich, London, Amsterdam, Toronto, Vegas, Boston, and that's all with just my current position. If you really want to be guaranteed travel, internal audits for you. Have to have accounting expertise and knowledge. So we do require people having a bachelor's degree at minimum. And we also look for people who either have a CPA or are CPA eligible or have a master's degree, but really the CPA is like the key factor. Because like I said, when you have a CPA license, that shows people in the accounting profession that you have the technical accounting knowledge. Some internal audit groups would like to have their certified internal auditor certificate as well. I haven't found it to be a requirement. Usually the requirement is CPA career progression. You start as an internal auditor, which is a staff, senior internal auditor, audit manager. Sometimes there's a senior manager position or just to director. From there on, it's VP of internal audit and that type of stuff. Now we're going to talk about public accounting. I have many, many videos about what it's like to be in public accounting, what I did when I was in public accounting, so I'm going to link all of that over here. Three different kind of career paths in public accounting. And when we talk about public accounting, that means you're an accounting firm, gets clients, and you do external audits, you perform tax services, you do consulting, performing services for your clients. So the first part of public accounting, of course, is assurance or external audit, which is what I did for 7 years. That is where you go to a specific company, you are tasked to audit their financial statements, which I will describe a lot more in other videos. And then at the end of that, the partner will provide an opinion on what the financial statements look like. Are they unqualified, meaning they look good, they meet standards, and there's no material, huge, significant issues or errors. So those are the general duties. Now, when it comes to travel, I wouldn't say it's guaranteed, but you're more likely than not going to have to travel. And that's one of the things that people who don't like to travel may not like public accounting as much. Sorry, the lighting is may go out on us because I'm using natural lighting. I don't need to go into a long spiel about public accounting because I have so many videos on it, but I really think that minimum 2-3 years on your resume does wonders. So if you can commit yourself to 2-3 years of I'm just gonna do whatever it takes and I'm gonna learn as much as I can and I'm gonna do it for as long as I can, then I think that's great for you and for your career in the long run. Traveling is just really gonna depend, especially when you first start in public accounting, when you don't know people or managers or whoever, and they just start assigning you to specific clients. You may be on a traveling client even if you don't want to. And of course you can communicate your preference. There are some people who want to travel and you can communicate that whenever you start with your public accounting firm. But there are some people who don't want to travel. You can make that known. Traveling opportunities are definitely there. Not everyone's going to love that, but it's part of the job. And I would say communicate about it if there is a specific reason why you can't travel. Obligations, stuff like that. You always hear about the typical busy season, which is January through the end of April, where you can be working from 55 hours minimum, 60 hours minimum. Usually there is a minimum requirement there, and it is definitely not 40 hours. Oftentimes I found that I worked a lot more, especially as I moved up in my career, I worked a lot more. You can see all my videos I talk about this. I'm not saying it's ideal, but it's just what it is. The thing that's different about external audit is you will rarely be in the office of your specific accounting firm. You will typically be going to different client offices. Another part of the external audit piece that I don't really talk about a whole lot, but that is important, is the IT audit. You really don't need an accounting degree for that. You could actually have a IT background. You're checking specific IT system related things for an accounting system. Things like appropriate access, change management, networking, things of that nature. So you don't need an accounting degree for that, but you do need IT knowledge for it. Check out my video that I did about public accounting. It'll give you a lot more information than I'm going to give now. In terms of education requirement, you definitely at minimum need a bachelor's degree, and you have to be CPA exam eligible to be even starting in public accounting. There are some firms that will allow, like if you are in the middle of getting your master's degree or getting CPA exam eligible, they'll allow you to start with them, but you have to have the intention of taking the CPA exam. Nice thing about public accounting is that there is a very specific layout, at least up until you make manager. And you can't make manager without a CPA license. The next part in public accounting that I'll talk about is tax. They are contracted by different companies, prepare like the tax provision, like I just talked about in industry. Instead of having your department do that, someone who has more specialized knowledge and expertise, like a public accounting firm, are the ones who do that for some companies. Also, like preparing tax returns, rather than it being done in-house by the company, they outsource it to a public accounting firm. Usually there is little to no travel. They're usually always in the actual office of the accounting firm. Very rarely will they go out to a client site. Maybe the partner or senior manager or whoever may go out to a client site to do a bid or something of that nature, but for the most part, you're in the office of the accounting firm if you're doing tax. Tax also has lots of busy seasons as well. The April 15th, then there's like September 15th, sometimes October 15th. They can work a lot of hours as well. Throughout the rest of the year, usually I think they would work a 40-hour work week. It just depends on the accounting firm. And I do think that they try to kind of balance that out with the busy season. And then lastly, and very shortly, another part of public accounting firms I'll talk about is the consulting or advisory portion of it. So this is where a public accounting firm will be the outsourced internal auditors. Just like I talked about me being an internal auditor for my company, maybe a company doesn't want to hire that headcount internally, and instead they outsource it to an accounting firm. Maybe they need some help implementing a new accounting standard, such as like a revenue recognition standard. Then you have people who are in the public accounting firm who have that specialized knowledge. They go in and consult for that company and do that work. Maybe that company doesn't have a person with that knowledge and expertise, and so that's why they would outsource that. So that is a general idea of the different accounting jobs that are out there. If this video was helpful, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. I would greatly appreciate it. Don't forget to be a part of our Subby fam because we would love to have you, and I'll talk to y'all in my next video. I'm gonna have my notes. Talking about, okay. And while they're closing the books, which is what I was describing earlier. So while people are closing the books, what'd you see? So the first, they are basically just, I'm just here to give you truth and what I've seen. So, okay, let's move on. So basically, that's just where like the most awesome people go to work, and you know, you just gotta be really just great and wonderful and just like a great person anyways. Just kidding. With great power comes great responsibility. Not saying that in accounting, you know, you have this power. That was a bad example. Let me turn on that light over there. Okay, sorry, lighting's gonna change because the sunset. Okay, y'all, I told y'all it was gonna be long, didn't I?